Billboard once called Ryan Tedder the undercover king of pop.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your love, would you rescue me?
And it's probably a pretty accurate title. I filmed and recorded this episode with him just before the COVID-19 outbreak, and I can tell you firsthand, he's a genius. You might know him as the frontman for OneRepublic. What you may not know is that Ryan is a music industry veteran, in-demand producer, and songwriter behind the songs for Adele, Beyoncé, Kelly Clarkson, Paul McCartney, and Taylor Swift, to name a few. He has a show on TV called Songland. He's an active investor in several categories, including commercial real estate. His latest venture has him jumping into the incredibly competitive beverage space with a drink called Mad Tasty. That's an all-natural, hydrating, restorative water beverage with zero sugar, no calories, and 20 milligrams of hemp extract with a flavor that's shockingly good. I've tasted it. His latest song, Didn't I, with OneRepublic, sounds like an instant hit. Hope you enjoy this episode as much as I did. Didn't we fly?
I'm Ryan Tedder. I'm a songwriter, producer, TV personality, and the lead singer of OneRepublic. And right now, you're watching Behind the Brand with Brian Elliott.
Hit a coffee shop on the 8th. Well, maybe it was in my mind. And I swear that I heard your laugh from a person that walked past me at a party the other night. Never thought we'd ever have to go without. Take you over anybody else, hands down. We're the top.
Hey, I'm Brian Elliott. Welcome to another edition of Behind the Brand. Today I'm here with the amazingly talented Ryan Tedder. Ryan, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
I usually ask my guests, how'd you get this job?
I got this job because I would have failed at any other job. I realized by the time I got to college, I had a completely realistic residing fear that I would get fired from any normal job. So I figured I had to create my own path, and I would have rather been broke and happy than paid and working for somebody.
Really? Yeah. Let's go back in the chronology. As far as back you want to take it, what did you want to be when you grew up?
The first memory that I have of anything that I wanted to do was acting. I was obsessed with theater. I still am. It's funny, I had my parents visiting this weekend and we talked just about like childhood and life, and I'm doing like four or five things right now in different, and all in different industries. And they said, my stepdad said, you know, none of this surprises me. Our biggest concern when you were a kid was not would you succeed at something, but how would you pick? Mm-hmm. And since I was a kid, I've said so many times, I wish reincarnation exists. I hope it exists because I actually do want to do multiple things. I wanted to at one point be a jet fighter pilot. I wanted to work for the CIA. I wanted to be an actor. I wanted to be a chef. But acting ultimately led me to musical theater, which led me obviously to music. My dad was a songwriter, a gospel songwriter way back in the day. I started playing piano at age three. Started writing creative poetry and things like that in early high school. And I had a teacher pull me aside and say, it's funny, my theater teacher pulled me aside and said, if you want to do this professionally, I think you can, and I'll get you a scholarship for acting by the time you graduate if you stick with this. And
wow.
She did.
Amazing.
And then my creative writing teacher, my English teacher, pulled me aside and said, I think you have a future as a writer. If you are interested in pursuing this, I think you really should. And so when all those worlds collided by the time I graduated, I ended up going to college, and the first summer after my freshman year, I kind of threw my future into the hands of God, fate, you know. I said, all right, I'm gonna apply for like six or seven film studios for an internship, and I'm gonna apply to six or seven record labels and music companies.
So at the time you were in Colorado?
This time I was in Colorado, yes.
Yeah.
And I'd done music all through high school. I was started writing songs when I was 15, and meanwhile I was acting. I was doing commercials, I was auditioning remotely whenever I could. I was born in Oklahoma, I was an only child, and I think there's something about not having I wish I had brothers and sisters that I'd grown up with. There's something about not having that distraction, especially pre-YouTube era, pre-internet era, that forces you to focus on something. I'd get home by myself and think, well, you know, there's nothing really good on TV.
Yeah.
There's a piano. I have a drum set, and I would do that. I'd play piano. I'd write songs. I'd listen to music. I would memorize monologues and recite them in the mirror in the bathroom and try to brush up my acting chops. And ultimately, I kind of thought I want to do acting so bad. I want to be a songwriter, a recording artist, a musician so bad. I can't pick. But I know that if I try to do them both at the same time, they might cannibalize each other. Mm-hmm. And I might just be mediocre at both. I want to be great at something. And so I applied to film studios and I applied to record labels for internships. And I did this weird kind of like fickle hand of fate, roll the dice thing where I thought whichever industry offers me the job, that's the one I'm going in on. So if I get a gig with Paramount Pictures or Sony Pictures, I'm going into film. I will be an actor, I'll be a producer, something. If I get a scenario with a record label or a publisher, I will go into music. Just so happens I landed an internship. I called everybody, and I ended up with an internship for DreamWorks. And initially, when they called me back, I thought, oh my God, Steven Spielberg, SKG, DreamWorks Pictures, this is gonna be incredible.
Yeah.
Turns out it was DreamWorks Music. And then I thought, oh, DreamWorks record label, that's amazing. They have Rufus Wainwright and you know, a bunch of other artists that I liked at the time, Eels and...
About what year was this?
2000.
Okay.
Something like that. And turns out it was DreamWorks Publishing. I didn't know what a publishing company was. And I found out that a publishing company is a songwriting company. It's the songwriting division of a music company. Mm-hmm. And they sign songwriters and they catalog songs and that's how they make their money. They own 25% of copyrights. And then I thought, all right, well, I'm gonna go to LA, work for a DreamWorks Publishing. Okay, it's not what I thought, but I'll do that.
You're in the vicinity.
I'm thinking, right? Yeah, in the vicinity, because LA was my dreamland since I was 10 years old. Since the first time I came to LA for spring break, I knew these were my people, this was my place. Like, I was meant to be in California, and I spent the rest of my life trying to get back here. And turns out that DreamWorks Publishing has an office in Nashville. That's where I ended up. And I ended up being an intern and cataloging songs and booking recording sessions. And I thought, well, this is where I'm supposed to be. So what can I do here that is like, what's the thing to do here? Well, songwriting. Fortunately, I was already writing songs. And I started taking every session that I could. I started producing demos for country writers that were trying to write pop songs. I would produce these pop demos for $300-$400, mm-hmm. make a little money. And that summer I auditioned. NSYNC was huge at the time, and it's the very end of their, like, you know, NSYNCness. And right. They came through town on a stadium tour, and they were holding auditions for a record deal, like trying to find local talent. They were doing a TV show on MTV, in like affiliated with TRL, which was at the time, as you probably remember, the biggest thing in the universe.
Yep.
And so they came through town. I auditioned with my original song, and after the audition, the local paper pulled me over and did an interview with me, which was my first interview. And the producer who formed NSYNC happened to be at that audition. And she said, hey, I think you're gonna win this.
Wow.
And about 4 weeks later, they flew me to New York on TRL. I performed a song and I won a record deal on TRL.
Did you just sing? Did you play guitar, piano?
I sang and played guitar. Okay. Brian McKnight was a judge, Pink was a judge.
Cool.
One of the NSYNC guys, Lance Bass, was a judge.
Yeah. And later became this big producer guy.
Yeah. And I think that was the first TV show that Lance produced, actually, because now he does TV shows and stuff. And that was my first kind of taste of fame. And I went from living in a dorm room in Tulsa, Oklahoma, attending college back where I was born. And I went from the dorm room to that. I mean, within 24 hours, I'm like staying at the Trump Hotel. That night I get into it. Lance is like, you should come out with us. We're going to hit the club tonight. I was like, I've never been to a club. That sounds amazing. I don't think I was even old enough to be in a club at that point. I get in the limousine and it was, I'll never forget this, it was Justin Timberlake, whoever he was dating at the time, Derek Jeter, Miss Universe, Lance Bass, and then like a couple guys Eitan and Nelson, who became my friends and now like my business partners for a bunch of other stuff. Yeah.
Wow.
So it was a very serendipitous weekend in New York, and that changed. And Timbaland happened to watch that show, and about a year later, Timbaland, who was at, he had just done Justin Timberlake's solo album, Nelly Furtado,
yeah,
Missy Elliott,
popping,
biggest producer writer in the world, and he cold calls me a year later while I was in Nashville and said, I'd like to fly you out to Miami and I'd like to sign you to a production deal and develop you as an artist and producer. And that started me on the career towards music. At that point, I sadly said goodbye to acting and went full tilt into music.
Wow.
Yeah, I just gave you the whole chronology.
Well, talk about a big break though. I mean, that was everything.
That was everything. Yeah, that was, you know, you have those defining moments in your life. And for people, you know, for me, a big part of it was I had teachers. I had my theater teacher, Mrs. Jordan, that when I was 14, you know, waited till class was over. And this was day one, class one theater. Couldn't have been more excited to be in that class. And after class, she said, Ryan, can you stay after? I thought I was in trouble. And she pulled me aside and we did a whole, day one was improv. So it was like, how can you maintain character, make people laugh, make people like, you know, scream, whatever. And she kept me after class and said, hey, that's when she told me, hey, I think you have a natural gift for this. I've been doing this for forever and I can spot them like that. I will get you a full ride scholarship for acting if you stay with me.
Wow.
That was a defining moment. 4 years later, I had a youth group leader who had been a touring drummer for Mariah Carey and funny enough was like one of the original members of Butthole Surfers, which is hysterical. And I was performing, I was playing music with our choir in Colorado at this point. Same deal, he pulled me aside afterwards and said, hey, I've done this a long time and like, if you want to do music full time, like professionally, you've got that extra thing that like you need to have to actually make it happen. Mm-hmm. I had two or three of those turning point moments that I hung my hopes on those small interactions that just gave you that, I'm supposed to do this, I can do this. And
yeah.
And I think those are the things that led me to where I was. If I hadn't, I don't know honestly if I would have gone after, if I hadn't had, because I had a lot of naysayers for sure. When you're growing up in, you know, the country outside of Oklahoma City or in Tulsa and you have a stepdad who's a banker, your mom's a school teacher, there's nothing around you that's really indicating, hey, you should move to LA and you should go into entertainment.
Well, and it's probably almost like, yeah, sure, okay, great.
That's exactly what I got.
Yeah.
I didn't tell anybody. Like my stepsisters, who I'm very close with, when I was on MTV, I hadn't told anybody. Nobody in my college knew I had flown to New York. Nobody knew I was gonna be on TV. My family didn't know. Nobody knew.
So good.
Because my thought was, I don't want to be the guy, and I've lived my whole life with this philosophy. I never want to be the guy that talks about stuff, that just like sits around and like, just kind of, you know, waxes philosophical on what might be or what you might do or what you could do. And I couldn't stand that. Like the boy who cried wolf stuff. Like you're talking about, I'm gonna do this. You know, it'd be really cool. I'm thinking about trying this, doing that.
Yeah.
People who talk all day long about really good ideas that, you know, things that they want to do with their life. And then they immediately come up with 30 reasons why not to.
A great subtle lesson I just want to underscore for people who are listening and watching. Ideas are one thing. You can have great ideas, but execution is everything.
It's everything, man.
Yeah.
The amount of... Music video is a good metaphor for that. You get pitched when you're a recording artist, you do music videos, right? They're very expensive, they're time consuming, there's a lot of people, a lot of production. Without fail, 9 times out of 10, the gap between what's called the video treatment, the treatment that you are pitched by a director on paper, phenomenal. Oh
yeah.
My God, this is going to be the best video we've ever done.
Yeah.
Like, I can't wait. This is insane. 90% of the time, you get the final product and you're watching it and you go, this is nothing.
Yeah.
Like,
what happened? Treatment.
What happened? And it's all execution.
Yeah.
100% execution. And I think the reason that I've undertaken so many different things. And I've always been, I mean, the blessing and the curse, at least of being me, and I live with it, is I'm not this person that's like, I need to climb Mount Everest. I need to run a marathon. I need to prove to myself that I can accomplish some outstanding human feat. And because especially when you get into your 30s and 40s, it's like we all get overtaken by something that, you know, some type of internal crisis where you need to prove that you're still healthy and you're still with it and you can still do stuff. And I've never had that. I just love the process. I'm executive producing a film this year with Margot Robbie and Brian Unkles called El Beso. It's a Mexican musical it's a Latin musical set place in Mexico. I don't really know that much about producing films, but I always knew that I wanted to, and I had enough people tell me the way you think or the way your mind works actually would work really well for film if you ever wanted to do that. And I said, well, when the right opportunity comes along and I know that I can actually deliver, I'll jump in. And the only way I know how to do anything, it's like, if I think I want to do something, if I think I want to do it, you jump in. Like that's it. You jump in and you either get right out because the water's too cold.
Yeah.
Or you find your footing and you acclimate, and then all of a sudden you're treading and then you're swimming and then you're racing. And I don't understand any other way to do it. I remember in college, this will give you an example. Like I would do multiple sports and then I was working two or three jobs at the same time. I had this definitely FOMO, right? I think anybody that's like me operates for a certain amount of FOMO. Like I'll have days where I'm sitting around in LA thinking about Paris and all of a sudden I'm getting jealous of everybody that's in Paris. I'm like, what am I missing right now in Paris? We should go to Paris. We should go to Tokyo, you know? And I have to shut all of that down because it really is this like app that doesn't turn off in the back of my head. But when I was in college, like I was the guy that on a Thursday night before spring break would just decide, I want to go to New York for spring break. Well, spring break starts tomorrow, or I want to drive to Chicago. And then I would have the idea, think about it during class that day, and then get back to the dorm room and walk up and down the hall and say, hey, I'm going to Chicago tomorrow, who wants to go? And I would look for a show of hands and then go spend a week in Chicago, crash on couches, you know, just figure it out. And I think that there are two kinds of people in life, people that like to get thrown into situations or throw themselves into situations and just figure it out. And that is the process, that's the fun. Can I figure this out? This is so different than anything I know. I haven't been taught how to do this. I wonder if I can figure it out. And then there's the people where that terrifies them.
Would you rescue me? Would you get my back? Would you take my call?
And this is how I see it. And I'm so like, if this becomes a single, I would just probably call Adam Wills and be like, we're doing this, let's go. Let's sit down, have one workshop together. We write it all down, map it out, let's go. So, start there. Actually, can I turn that up? I want to hear that.
Oh, yeah. I didn't want to ruin it.
Oh, you're testing ears, yeah.
No, I know, it's just, you're going to mark right
back. Would you take my call?
This kid running through the woods, right? And he's looking behind himself.
Yeah.
And like tripping over stuff. And you don't realize that. And he's like, right, keeps running. And then, right? You see another kid on a bicycle wearing a mask, chasing him through the forest, like on a BMX. Another kid behind him, another kid behind him.
Sick.
And you've got like four or five of these kids, right? And you realize this is what this kid's running from. He's like getting cut, scratched,
karate
right?
Kid. Yeah.
Right? Yeah, exactly. So then. Okay. So at this point, comes to the backyard of somebody's house, hops the fence, whatever. See him running. Ends up in the street right here, neighborhood street, like Stranger Things. Shoot. Bikes. Kid.
Yeah. Yeah, just like, super, you know, like, yeah.
And then it's like,
it's almost like a 70s action.
70s, Shikutsu, right? And you see this kid go, and he's like this. And he's like, like, and he starts dancing,
just
right?
Like disarming them with the dance, like, yeah.
Like, you know, he's slow motion.
Totally. He's,
you know, all this shit. And then he goes.
like he points at one of these kids and he's like literally like the drum kit, right?
Yeah.
Flies
yeah,
off
yeah,
the thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So did you see him take off again, right? Kids are following him down the street. Cut to the good kids riding it the other way. And they're coming to rescue this kid, right? And the kid's still running. And these kids are like yelling at him on their bikes, they're shaking their bats, whatever. Finally he rounds a corner, sees all his friends. Cut to the bad guys on the bike. They screech to the halt here. All five of the good kids doing this.
Yeah,
and they,
what?
Dude, literally
yeah,
walking
West
towards.
West Side Story, man. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
West Side Story, walking towards
yeah,
the bad kids.
I love
and then
this
it, they kind of form this, starts to form this circle. And then it becomes like literally breakdancing fucking dance off. Like that's how they're battling. That's how they're battling.
I love this
yeah.
So much.
We don't talk much, not anymore. Broken bottles are slamming doors. But we still care about each other. Say we care about each other. I know life took us far away, but I still dream about the good old days when we took care of each other. We were living for each other. And God,